So good evening all. Shantam da, can we start now? It's 8 p.m.
Yeah, and yeah. Today, can you hear me?
Yes, yes. Today we have Dr. Shantam Chakraborty, who is senior consultant, radiation oncologist in Tata Medical Center, Calcutta. And Shantam da is our all-time favorite teacher. So you can expect a fantastic class today. So Shantam da will be taking today's class on treatment planning part one, isodose distribution. So Shantam da, please start.
Thank you, Sam. I hope I am clearly audible to everyone. And yes, today, I think we will take this class a little bit in a fun way. We'll try to make it a little bit more interactive. Before we do that, let us look and review our learning objectives for today, because there will be some portions of this textbook which I will not be teaching today, which I expect you will go back and read yourself. So the learning objectives will be to understand the parameters of isodose and isodose charts, understand how double field and multi-field dose distributions work, and understand the influence of wedges on isodose distributions. Wedges are very important beam modifying devices, and it will be interesting if you participate in the polls to test your understanding. So now I will start a dummy poll, which you should be able to see on your screen in Zoom. Once you are there, please vote on this poll. And I want to see how many of you are able to do it. We will give some time. I will give a time of some 20-30 seconds in between. And while these polls are going on, I will be taking a few questions in between also, so that people who have voted don't have to wait unnecessarily. Right, so 30 seconds have nearly elapsed. I think most of you are able to see the polling option in your screen, and most of you are able to poll. Now, unfortunately, Zoom does not allow us to set up quizzes, otherwise that would have been a more fun thing to do. Nonetheless, around 11% of you are saying that you are enjoying some of the viral physics classes. So that is interesting. We should definitely get your feedback on which classes you did not enjoy. Somebody mentioned that he doesn't know whether he's enjoying it or not. That's interesting also. So we have 99 out of 127 people who have voted. I think I will end this poll. Great. Now, let us go to the actual presentation. So what are isodose and what are isodose charts? Isodoses are simple. These are lines connecting the points which receive the same dose in a volume in a plane. Now the two words are important. There is a volume in which the dose is going, and you are seeing the representation of this dose in a plane. Now, why is this necessary? This is necessary because, as we all know, when radiation passes through matter or any material, it slowly deposits energy along the track. And depending upon the energy, depending upon various parameters like the field size, where the radiation is coming from, all of these parameters influence how this energy is going to be deposited. Now, because this energy deposition is not uniform, when you are doing the planning, you need to understand what your volume is actually receiving in order to give accurate radiotherapy. And this is why, before the advent of computers, when people started planning radiotherapy, isodose charts came into being. Now, what are isodose charts? These are a set of isodose lines. So what it means is that this will be a set of isodose lines pertaining to a certain field geometry, and they will be at defined intervals of dose, typically at 10% intervals, drawn along a plane in the volume. So what it means is that you will be basically seeing this isodose distribution along a certain plane. Now, this is also important to understand, because if you are doing your treatment planning using isodose charts, you must be careful about which plane this isodose chart has been drawn in. And what is the need for these isodose charts? We had our previous classes where we understood how dose to points could be calculated, right? We need these isodose charts to basically calculate the off-axis dose distribution, to demonstrate these dose distributions in a manner which can be easily understood by everyone. and to optimize this dose distribution so that you can give correct radiotherapy. Now, there are certain conventions we have to follow when we are doing, when we are seeing or when we are reviewing isodose charts. First of all, isodose charts are usually obtained in the principal plane. And what do we mean by the word principal plane? The word principal plane means the plane which contains the central axis of the beam. So this is important. If you have a 10 by 10 field size, you essentially would have an isodose chart typically either along the x-axis or along the z-axis. Now, these will be typically drawn with a 1:1 scale. So people who have worked in machines or centers where cobalt radiotherapy equipment was present would have seen some radiotherapy charts like this. They will usually have a central axis drawn. And the reason for this is something that I will touch upon briefly. One thing very important to understand, and this is a very common mistake which students make when they are asked to draw isodose lines, is that isodose lines never touch the surface, never intersect with each other. Reason? Isodose is a line which joins a particular dose. So a particular point cannot have two doses at the same time. So that's why isodose lines can never intersect with each other. So this is the two cardinal mistakes which you should never make when you are drawing isodose charts. Next thing is, field size is indicated in the text and in the chart. And this is important to read, because when you are planning or when you are using this isodose chart, you obviously want to use an isodose chart which is correct for your patient population. The next thing is that the point of maximum dose and the depth of normalization. Depth of normalization is what? The point at which you prescribe the 100% isodose, or you want your 100% isodose to be there. That is the depth of normalization. So these are the two important things that should be present in every isodose chart. Now, how are isodose charts obtained? Now, in the olden era, what used to happen is that obtaining an isodose chart was not easy. So oftentimes, charts would come with machine, and this would be made very easy in machines like telecobalts, where we would see that there would be a big box of sheaf of isodose charts which would come, which would be used by our physicists for treatment planning. Subsequently, because when linear accelerators came into being, we realized that linear accelerators have a heterogeneous energy distribution. So they have a spectrum of energy. And because they are not monoenergetic, the isodose charts of one machine cannot be easily used in another machine. And therefore, what happened was, they started coming up with atlases for linear accelerators. However, later on, when the availability of dosimetry equipment like radiation field analyzers became more common, they started to be obtained at the center. And now it is a part of the treatment plan commissioning process that you have to obtain isodoses in an RFA before AERB gives you license for operating the machine. And why is this necessary? If you see this figure, you will see there is a wide variation in the way the doses are for different field sizes, for different machines, for different energies. So there is a huge variation, right? Now, this is the reason why you need to have the isodose for your machine. In cobalt, what used to happen was, because it is a monoenergetic energy source, and if your machine follows the same rule as another machine, you will get the same isodose distribution unless and until something is really wrong with your collimator or your source position. So this is the reason why you need to have proper isodose measurement for all your linear accelerators. Now let's run another poll. So this is the second poll. And in this, the question that I'm asking is, in the figure which you have seen, all the curves are intersecting at a particular point. This point is known as the depth of maximum dose, the depth of minimum dose, the normalization depth, depth of peak air karma. I think nearly half of the people or half of the audience has already voted. And a few more votes are trickling in. But we have got the lay of the land. So most of you have correctly identified this as the normalization depth. Some of you have gotten it wrong. You have said Dmax, minimum dose, and the depth of peak air karma as the answer. Now, of course, it is not the Dmax because Dmax is the depth of maximum dose. The reason why these points are intersecting is that these isodose lines have been obtained after normalizing or making sure that the same dose is being delivered at 10 centimeter depth. Therefore, the correct answer is the normalization. Right. Let's go back to the slides. So before we go into the minutiae of isodose charts, let's quickly review radiation field analyzers. For most of your centers, there would be a radiation field analyzer, and I will urge all of you to go to your physics team and find out the nitty-gritties of this machine. This is a very important machine. When you go back in your professional career, you will actually need to be in the purchase committee for these machines. So you need to know a little bit about it. What is important is that this is a water phantom, of course. This is a very large water phantom. And a huge water phantom is required so that you can measure all sorts of beam geometries. So typically we have a 50 by 50 centimeter cube with a depth of at least 40 centimeter. And one thing is very important that the radiation field analyzer will allow you to measure the depth across the entire profile in the x-axis, the y-axis, as well as in the z-axis. So this is the reason why this machine can give you isodose charts. Now, typically these will have stepper motors, although the latest ones will have DC motors, and they have an accuracy of movement of around 1 millimeter with a precision of 0.5 millimeter. What happens is that we set this up under the machine. We have a reference chamber, which is placed usually in the air, and we have a measurement chamber, which is placed at a particular depth in the water. This measurement chamber will traverse the beam in various axes, recording the dose with the respect to the reference chamber at each point. And from this, we will get the isodose distribution, or rather, we will get the dose in the volume for a particular field. So this is a very important machine and an equipment that you must know about. Now, what are the key characteristics in any isodose curve in any isodose chart? First of all, dose falls off as the depth increases. Now, although this sounds very simple, please remember that all our complications in radiotherapy, all our complications in treatment planning are because of this single phenomenon, that as the depth increases, our dose falls off. If we could have had a system whereby we could have used a system like, you know, focusing solar x-rays, solar rays using magnifying glasses, we would have never needed to do all of this unnecessary tomfoolery. Then life would have been much more simpler. We would have been able to point out or focus the x-rays at a particular point, getting a very high dose to the area where we want, and giving the minimum possible dose to the surrounding organs. Unfortunately, physics makes it impossible, and therefore we are left to do several kinds of jugglery, which is known as treatment plan. Now, dose at the central axis is generally the highest. We will see that this may not be true for certain situations. There are exceptions. The dose falls off in the periphery, and this area is also known as the penumbra. And the reason is because of geometric penumbra and because of reduced side strata. Now, beyond the limits of the geometric field, dose is contributed by the side scatter, by the collimator scatter, and the collimator leakage. Now, what is the difference between scatter and leakage? The difference is scatter is radiation generally of a low energy, which comes following a typical interaction event, say a Compton interaction with the collimator assembly or any other beam modifying device which you have placed in the beam path. Therefore, this will be a low energy photon. Leakage radiation, on the other hand, is the same energy as the primary beam. And when you come to your classes which deal with radiation safety, you will understand that the reason we have different thicknesses of walls in the room is because of the need to take care of leakage radiation. Now, this is what we call as a beam profile. How is this different from an isodose chart? See carefully. Here, the line is not joining the same dose. The dose is different. Here it is, the along a particular field size, along the beam profile, you are seeing how the dose is behaving. So at this depth, you have 100%. Here you have 90%. Here you have 80%. Here you have 70%. So this is basically a cross section. So this is the beam profile. Now, let us understand what all things this beam profile tells us. The first thing it tells us is these two horizontal lines which I have drawn are at 80 and 20% isodose. Now, why did I make these lines? People who have attended the previous class will immediately catch on that these are the regions of the physical penumbra. So here what happens is that the dose is sharply falling off. So you can see within a few millimeters distance from this area, the dose has already fallen from 80% to the 20%, right? So this is the region of physical penumbra. And this line, which is the dashed line, is at the level of the 50% isodose. Again, people who have attended the last time's class will know this is the definition of the field size. So what is important to understand is that your field size does not contain the useful beam. Once again, the field size does not contain the useful beam. The useful beam is typically smaller than the field size. And this is a very, very important thing to understand. Whenever you have a field size of 10 by 10 centimeter, typically you are not treating a length of 10 by 10 centimeter. You are treating less than that. And how less depends upon several factors. Now let's run another poll. Please take a careful look at this picture. So here we have three panels, panel A, panel B, and panel C, which show different kinds of isodose charts. And here I am launching a poll with three questions. The first question asks, among these three figures, which isodose distribution will be most suitable for treatment in the shaded area? The second question asks, why does the isodose curve in the panel A bulged out laterally? And the third question is, why does the isodose curve in panel C bulge out laterally? So take your time, give an answer while I give the answer to one question that has come. That is, why does different linear accelerator of the same make have different dose profiles? Very good question. The answer is that your linear accelerators do not produce the same kind of energy. That is, it is not a monoenergetic beam source. How does a linear accelerator produce X-rays? Through Bremsstrahlung production, which comes from electron interactions with the target. So obviously, depending upon how you have tuned the linear accelerator, you will have a slight difference in the energy profile of the beam. Also, in addition to that, you may have slight differences in the alignment. So what is the tuning of the linear accelerator? Tuning of the linear accelerator is basically like tuning, you know, if you had done those physics experiments with the tuning fork, it's something like that. You have to have a resonant frequency at which you get the perfect waves so that the electrons strike your target properly. So that's why you have different dose profiles. Now, when we are actually doing the commissioning, what we are trying to do is trying to make sure that our linear accelerator has got an energy distribution which is acceptable, which means our physicists will make sure that 80%, 90%, or the 50% isodoses of particular energy will be at specific depths. And this will be a part of the questions that they or the pro forma they will be having to fill during the commissioning process. I hope this answers the question. So the second question is, if so, it is correct to transfer plans from one machine to other in the event of a machine breakdown? Vishnu, The answer is yes, if you have a beam match machine where the profile of one machine is exactly the same as the other machine. Okay, so 2 minutes have elapsed. Now I will end the polling and see the results. The first question was, among the three figures, which isodose distribution is more suitable for the treatment of the shaded area? Most of you have actually identified the answer as B as correct. And the reason for it is simple, right? Why is that so? Here in this region, your isodose is ranging between plus minus 10% or maybe plus minus 12%, right? In the same region over here, if you see, it is varying by almost 20%. This is a huge variation. Now, this kind of isodose chart is typically obtained in ortho voltage, which is useful for treating superficial tumors. So if you have tumors lying over here, you would be using this beam energy. Now, this is actually the same energy. This is cobalt. This is also cobalt. What has happened over here is that the source size is more over here. Now, remember, one of the important factors which determines how the penumbra proceeds is the size of the source. And here, the source size is large. And as a result of which, what you can see is that although at the central axis, you have nearly got the same dose distribution, peripherally, the dose distribution is very bad. So over here in this region, your dose distribution will be between 70% to 50%. So that's why if you have to treat this tumor with a homogeneous dose distribution, you should be going for this energy. Another big advantage of this energy is, of course, your field size will be smaller. So lateral tissue over here and here will not get an excessive amount of dose. And these are the answers to the next two questions. So here you have an ortho voltage energy, which has got a significant side scatter profile. And that's why you have these bulges in the isodose curves. On this side, the source size is larger. So although it is the same cobalt machine, the isodose lines are different. So this is important. The cobalt does not require isodose measurements. It's a wrong concept unless and until you have a perfectly same machine. Okay, now let's move on. So let's review the concept of penumbra once more. Here we have a perfect beam. A perfect beam means here we have a perfect point source beam, which miraculously does not require collimation. All the photons are forward directed, even the scatter photons. Will you have any penumbra in this situation? The answer is no. Why? Because here every interaction occurs in the forward direction. Electrons are also coming out in the forward direction, and the dose is deposited in this manner. But this is not the real life, right? What happens in real life is that you have electrons, you have scattered photons, and the reason why dose falls off along this region is that this photon has a greater chance of coming and depositing energy near the central axis as compared to the periphery. And therefore, what we see is that there is a sharp fall off of dose near the edge of the beam because this is the region of penumbra. So this is how scatter causes the penumbra. What is the transmission penumbra? Transmission penumbra is the penumbra that originates because of the way our collimator blocks are placed. And what happens as a result over here, you can see that a portion of the beam is getting attenuated. And as a result, you get a lot of low energy photons over here, which produces a lower dose region, which is called as the transmission penumbra. Now, unfortunately, our sources are not pinpoint. Our sources have a finite size. And this is what gives rise to the concept of the geometric penumbra. The edges of the beam, edges of the source, also produce photons which travel in this line. And as a result of which, you can see how the dose distribution changes. So all three of these scatter, transmission, and the geometric source size contribute to the origin of the penumbra. And penumbra is a concept that you must always keep in mind when you are doing treatment planning, because please remember, if you have to treat a 10 centimeter target, it doesn't mean that you have to put a 10 centimeter field. This is very important. You have to know the penumbra of your machine. And if you're working with low energy photons like cobalt, the penumbra typically should be in the region of a centimeter or so. You need to give this much margin. Now, beam quality. What is beam quality? What are the factors on which this isodose depends? First is beam quality. Beam quality is the energy spectrum. Remember, this is basically obtained from the distribution of the photons. And what does the beam quality determine? The depth of the isodose as well as the lateral spread of the isodose. We just saw some slides ago how, depending upon the energy, the size of your penumbra changes, right? Let us take a look at these few example isodose charts. These are isodose charts which we have taken from our own machine. This is a 6 MV isodose chart. This is a 10 MV isodose chart. And this is a 15 MV isodose, right? What do you understand from this? First of all, energy results in increased penetration, right? So this 80% isodose is at a depth of 6.35 centimeters for 6 MV and at 9.25 centimeters for 15 MV. What has happened to the penumbra? Interestingly, it is not true that increasing the energy will always result in a reduced penumbra. So over here, you can see for 6 MV, your penumbra width, that is the distance between the 20% and the 80% isodose curves, is 0.4 centimeters, while it is 0.5 centimeters for a 15 MV beam. Now, clinically, this difference does not make a huge difference. But what you have to understand is that in areas where the tissue attenuation is lower, for example, in cases of lung, this penumbra width increases. And this is an interesting exam question that often comes, whether the penumbra width is more in a 15 MV beam versus a 6 MV beam, particularly in areas like lung. And the reason for this is quite simple, right? You have the scattered photon which contributes to the dose of this area. The scattered photons which originate from a 6 MV beam will have much lower energy as compared to the scattered photons which come from a 15 MV beam, as a result of which the dose splay, I should say, increases over a certain energy. Now let's go to the next slide. Now this slide shows you, this is a familiar thing. You remember the dose profile picture. So what did we do? We did a profile along the central axis. See, over here, if I did the profile along this line, I get this dose distribution. So what happens is, if I do the profile along this line, I get this dose distribution. So what happens over here is that in between from here to here, you have your useful beam. Remember, around 80% isodose. Beyond this, your beam is sharply falling off the energy. 0.44 centimeter is this region of penumbra. So this region. And if I draw the profile along the central axis, you get the familiar curve, right? You remember this curve. So here is the point where this Dmax is going to happen. You can see this red line touches the 100% isodose. And remember I told you just a few slides ago, usually the central axis will have the highest dose. This is true for most linear accelerators, but for this region, these are horns. Why do these happen? Because of the presence of the flattening filter. Now remember that whenever X-ray interacts, whenever electrons interact with your target, the energy distribution of the photons is such that more energetic photons are directed forward, less energetic photons will have a different angle. They will typically not be very forward directed. So what happens is, when you have this situation, the energy results in greater energy deposition along the central axis. And as a result, you will see that the isodose curves will peak out like this if you do not have a flattening filter. What happens with a flattening filter is that we preferentially attenuate the beam in the central part of this isodose line. We have less attenuation over here so that the final isodose becomes flat. Now, because we want this flatness at a particular depth, this overcompensates. So that's why you have these horns. And if you go back one slide, you will remember that the horn size changes, right? For 15 MV beam, you can see the horns are much more prominent than a 6 MV beam. This is again because of the way the flattening filter interacts with this energy. The next thing which determines the isodose is the source size. We all saw this example where increasing source size resulted in increased geometric penumbra. And as a consequence of this, what happens is that the isodose also becomes a little bit more curved. The next thing is source distance. Now remember, closer the source is, you will have lesser the PDD, and that's why your isodoses will tend to fall off sharply. Further the source, you will have more the PDD, and that's why your isodoses will tend to fall off slowly. How do we use this clinically? Some of you may have heard of total body irradiation. Some of you may have seen total body irradiation. Now, what do we typically do in total body irradiation is that we want to treat the entire body with a dose with plus minus 10% homogeneity. Now, an usual person's body is such a thick thing that it is often difficult to get this properly. And that's why in order to encompass the length, what we often have to do is we have to position the patient very far off from the beam. This big advantage that we get from this is that our PDD increases. And that is what does it mean? It essentially means that the separation between the isodose increases. And as a result of which, we get a more homogeneous dose across the body. So this is one of the reasons why people still tend to prefer to treat the patients at a larger distance from the machine. The next thing which determines this isodose chart or isodose distribution is the source to diaphragm distance. Diaphragm is nothing but the collimator. And of course, you can understand closer the collimator is to the body, the lesser the penumbra will be. Remember the transmission penumbra? Closer you make it to the patient's body, less the penumbra will be. Of course, you have to remember that the collimator is also responsible for scatter. Therefore, if you keep it very close to the patient's body, you get a lot of low energy photons, which completely ruin the skin sparing effect that you get from megavoltage radiation. The next two important things which determine how your isodose looks like are collimation and the flattening filter. One thing important to remember is that the field size is directly proportional to the depth of the isodose for the same energy. So up to a certain size increase, you will see that the depth of isodose increases. And the reason is, of course, the scatter increases. The collimator position influences the geometric penumbra. So if you have a collimator which is placed lower down, your geometric penumbra will be reduced. Your beam will become sharper. Flattening filter influences the flatness of the beam. And typically what we mean by flatness is how flat or how straight the isodose is along this line. So if I draw a straight line along this, how much does this isodose differ from this point in central axis? When we are doing clinical radiation planning for a flattened beam, we typically target it to be within plus to minus 3% of the central axis dose. Usually this will be measured at 10 centimeter. And the reason is easy to understand. Depending upon the depth, the flatness changes. Now, flattening filters results in the horn in the isodose, which we have already discussed. Now, isodoses for a single side are typically not very useful. Why? Because we rarely treat from one side. So it is important concept to understand how to combine isodose charts, because we typically treat with more than one field. So this is a graphical example of how we go about the process. So what is this point? The central dot is the depth of Bmax. You have the central line over here, which you should align with the central axis of the beam entry. So what we will typically do is that during the simulation process, we will mark the points where we want the beam to enter from. And when we do this planning, we would make sure that the central axis of our isodose chart aligns with that center point. Now remember that this is a made up isodose chart, so that's why you have these sharp edges. A real isodose chart looks much smoother. Now, this is the same isodose chart done from the backside. Okay, I've just reversed it. Now, what is happening over here is that if you see that when we want to see the dose distribution of the two fields, we are basically looking at two isodose charts superimposed amongst each other. And this is what comes out when we superimpose this thing. Now, what is happening over here is that, you can see that if you have the 80% isotose over here, this beam is giving the 60% isotose over here, right? And this is what our problem is. We want to make sure a target which lies in this area gets the highest possible dose, and this area gets the lowest possible dose. Now, in order to calculate the dose, what we typically would be doing is that we would be dividing this area into a grid. Now, if we do it manually, it is quite tedious, but some of you may have done this. This would be resulting in a 1 by 1 centimeter grid. You can do it with a graph paper. And what we'll be doing is we will start calculating the dose from both the beams at each point in the grid. So at this point in the grid, you can see it is receiving 70 plus 70 is equal to 140%. This here it is 80, here it is 60, 140 again. Here it is nearly 100 and this is nearly 50, so around 150. In the center of the beam, nearly 70-70 both together, you have 140. So what is the key take? The key take is that towards the periphery of the beam, you have got a higher dose, typically in the order of 150%. In the periphery, you will have 140%. And remember, on the sides, because this area, the dose is around 60% or so, you will have 60 plus 60, around 120-130% of the prescribed. So this is what the composite isodose chart looks like. So the composite isodose chart tells you that the tumor is getting covered by 140% isodose. Now, what does this mean? Suppose you have used an SSD geometry isodose chart and you have said that I will give 100 centigrade to the Dmax, right? So these areas will give 100 centigrade from this beam, 100 centigrade from this beam, and total in this area will be 150 centigrade, in this area will be 150 centigrade, in this area will be 140 centigrade. This is all very good if you want to give 140 centigrade to a tumor, but that's typically not the case always. What we want to do is we want to treat the tumor to around 180 to 200 centigrade. So what we will typically do is follow a simple unitary method. We know to give 140 centigrade, our output from one side needs to be X. So 1 centigrade will be output by 140. 200 centigrade will be output divided by 140 into 200, or simply output multiplied by 1.43. So what we need to do is that we need to give a 43% increase in the output from either field, both the fields, to give a dose of 200 centigrade at the tumor. This dose of 200 centigrade in the tumor is known as the prescribed dose. And the given dose, which is 143 centigrade, will be the given dose, that is the dose delivered at the reference point, in this case the Dmax. If you are doing planning with the SAD technique, what will happen is you will have the situation where you will basically have the depth of the isodose in normalized in such a manner that it typically would lie at the center of the tube. This is known as the ICRU reference point in many cases, and as a result of which you will always get 100% in this region. What you essentially have to see is what is the doses to this part and this part. So planning with an SAD technique is typically a little bit simpler as compared to an SSD technique if you are using isodose charts. Now, the issue is that we are not treating blocks, right? This is a simple block, a very simple solution. A tumor is placed perfectly in the center and it is a perfect round, and you are having isodoses which are perfectly same. This will never come. You will have often situations like this. And mind you, Dr. Ganesh had mentioned this book, Meredith and Massey. I'm pretty sure most of you would have heard of this book. Please read this book. This is a very, very useful book to read. And if you are beginning with radiation physics, this is the book you should read, not Faiz Khan. Now, this is an example tumor, three beams, two from the posterior obliques, one from the anterior side. And this is the region we want our treatment to be, right? So here is the isodose chart from one side. Here will be the isodose chart from another side. Here is the isodose chart from the third side. And you will combine, right? But typically most places will be doing is that they will be dividing this grid into a number system. So A, B, C, D from here, 1, 2, 3, 4 from here, and they will make a table like this. Now, because we have the same beam coming from both the sides, the doors over here will be exactly the same as doors over here if this and these two beams are in the same position. So that's why what we see is that each of these have J and L, for example, J and L over here, and the point 4 over here receives a particular dose. So here is the dose from this field, the posterior field, that is this field that is the oblique field. Then this field is 93, which is field number 2, that is the anterior field. And field number 3, that is this oblique beam, is giving another 34 centimeters. Okay. Now, why this difference is happening is because of the distance from which these points are placed. So here, for example, this point is receiving 153 centigrade, this one 158 centigrade, this one 154 centigrade, and this one 149 centigrade. Assuming that you are delivering 100 centigrade to the DMAX, or you are using an SSD based planning technique. So you can understand immediately that this dose is not uniform, right? The dose variation between the indicated points in these points is around 6%. The dose variation in the treated region is as high as 14%. Now, if you go to the ICRU recommendations, what the recommendation typically, your dose in the target volume should not vary more than plus minus 5% of the prescribed dose. Lower dose side, because we want to emphasize tumor control, we do not accept anything less than 5%. Higher dose, we can accept depending upon where the high dose is located. So up to 107% is considered as acceptable. So therefore, what we can see is that here, the treated region is definitely not getting the dose which is correct. And this is where isodose-based planning comes into play. This is the situation for most tumors, because most tumors will not be perfectly centrally placed in a cube. So what we typically see is that, for example, these two points, right? They are receiving 163 centigrade and 153 centigrade. And why is this happening? Very simple to understand. This beam is having a lesser energy deposition as the depth increases, and as a result of which it gives a higher dose here as compared to here. So we can see this. I have made this table at point K6, which is the top point. You can see the dose is 163 centigrade, and it is coming 83 centigrade from this field, field number 2. From both the oblique fields, this is receiving 40 and 40 centigrade. Why? Because this is equidistant from both the fields. Point K12, the dose is getting 57 from this posterior. So you can see the dose has fallen off sharply. The dose to the oblique fields is 48. Why? Because it is closer. So this point is closer as compared to this point, right? So this point receives less dose from these obliques. This point receives more dose from the oblique. So what is happening is that the anterior field is giving an excess dose of 26 at the point K6, and oblique fields are giving an excess dose of 16 at point K12. Now here is the interesting concept. What we are trying to do when we are doing treatment planning is making these doses same. Why? We are not interested in making sure that all things get 163. We are perfectly fine with giving 130 around each every point. The reason is, remember the word normalization. If we have 130 uniformly in each of these points, we can easily adjust the given dose to be more than 100 centigrade by adjusting the time or the monitor units to ensure that you get 200 centigrade. But if you give 200 centigrade from, if you try to give a dose which results in 200 centigrade here, you will get an underdose. If you try to give 200 centigrade here, you will get an overdose. So that's why it is important to build up homogeneity. Now, the way we do that is to balance this dose. What we need to do is that we need to reduce the dose from one of the fields. It is easy to do it for the posterior field in this case. And therefore, we can reduce it by a factor of 16 divided by 26. 16 from this one, 26 from this one, or 61%. Of course, you can understand if you try to do this balancing for each and every point, you are basically going to spend time planning each and every patient for at least 2 or 3 days. Not possible. So what physicists would do is an approximation. What they would do is that they would calculate the dose at the center of the field. So this is the center of the field where the central axis of all the three beams intersect. And this point, that is K9 is receiving a dose of 158. 44 from each of the oblique beams and 70 from field number 2. This is a posterior field. So what we need to do is that we need to make sure that all the three fields are giving exactly the same dose. So if the lateral fields are giving 44 and the anterior field or the posterior field is giving more, that is 70, we need to scale the dose of the anterior field down. We need to bring 70 down to 44. Now, how do we do that? We multiply it by a factor F. So 70 into F is equal to 44. What is F? 44 divided by 70, unitary method. So this is equal to 63%. So what we need to do is that we need to multiply 70 by 0.63 to get 44. Simple mathematics. There is no complication in this. We have reduced the dose down by around 1/3. And this is what weighing of the beam is. So we have weighted the beam by 0.63. The posterior beams are weighted by 1. These oblique beams are weighted by 1. The posterior by 0.63. If you keep this 1, you can increase this dose also, 1.3. It will give you the exactly the same result. So this is what typically happens when you are doing beam balancing or adjusting the weightage. Now let us come to a different situation. We are having these two isodose distributions. Okay. Looking exactly the same, 6391.4 centigrade is the Dmax. This is the 95% isodose distribution. The only difference is that in this situation, two fields are getting treated per day. And here, only one field is getting treated. So one day, one field, next day, the other field. The dose distribution looks exactly the same. And believe me, if you take a DVH, they will be superimposed. So now my third pole. Okay, so what is this third pole? The question is, which of the following field arrangements is better? Panel A, which is 2 fields per day, panel B, 1 field per day, and panel, the answer is both are equivalent. The third answer is both are equivalent. Okay, meanwhile, I will answer the question of Dr. Anindya Mukherjee, who asks, what is the difference between beam flatness and beam symmetry? Flatness is basically the deviation of the dose at a particular point, at a particular depth from the dose at the central axis. Symmetry is the difference between two halves of the beam, to put it simply. Okay. We'll wait for some more time. Around 60% voting has occurred. Very good. And it seems like most of you are correct. Very good. So I'm talking to an audience which also already knows its basics. Great. We'll give it some more time. I think no more answers are coming. Perfect. We'll end the polling here. Okay. 74% of you have said treating 2 fields per day is the correct way to go. 30% feel both are equivalent or 1 field per day is the way to go, right? Now, if you think about it, imagine that you are in a center which is treating many patients each day and your radiographer says that, sir, why do I want to treat the machine on both the sides? It takes time to rotate the gantry for each patient. Let me treat the posterior on one day and the anterior on the other. saves time, I can treat more patients. What is the problem with this approach? Let us see. The problem that arises from this is because of the lateral edge effect. And remember, all of these are nothing but the problem that arises from the fact that your dose falls off as the depth increases. All of these arise from the same phenomenon. There is no difference in this, just the name changes. So what is the lateral edge effect? That at greater depth, the central portion of the field receives a higher dose than at the peripheral. Similarly, depth receives a lower dose as compared to peripheral tissues. Okay, peripheral tissues means superficial tissues. So as a consequence, the dose distribution across the tumor from a single field is never homogeneous. It is always variable. And here we have a chart taken from FASCAN. This is possibly the only chart which I have taken from FASCAN because it explains the point so nicely. It is showing the plotting between the patient thickness on the x-axis and the maximum ratio between the peripheral and the midpoint dose on the y-axis. What does it show? That as compared to the central part and the peripheral part, Cobalt 60 gives nearly 1.25 times dose, which means that your peripheral tissues receive nearly 25% excess as compared to the midpoint. In 25 MB beams, this is much less, around less than 5% or around say 4 or 5% or something like that. 4 MB beam, which is considered to be dosimetrically equivalent to Cobalt 60, it's around 1.15, okay, around 15%. Now, the reason why we do not want to treat these patients with one field per day is this. So what happens if we go to one field per day and get the exact same distribution? Let's go back. To achieve this dose distribution, we have to treat like this. So here the prescription is at the isocenter, which is placed at the center of the tumor, the SAD technique. What is happening over here is that I am delivering a dose of 200 centigrade to the isocenter. This portion is receiving slightly more than 200 centigrade. This portion is receiving significantly less than 200 centigrade. The next day, the posterior beam is being treated. This portion is now receiving more than 200 centigrade. This portion is receiving less than 200 centigrade. The consequence of this is that every day there is a portion of tumor which does not receive your prescribed dose. So although you think that the total sum dose is the same, the biological effectiveness of this dose is very different. And we know from very good clinical experience that if you try to do something like this, your tumor control rate will be lower. So what some astute physicians may want to do, why don't we give the prescription such that every day the tumor receives 200 centigrade, right? You can do that very easy. You just prescribe it to a point which is at the periphery of the tumor. So here in this case, the depth is more, here in this case to this. Simple. Now see what will happen. Here is your two field treatment. Here is your 1 day treatment. See how much the dose has increased. Here it was 6394 as the cumulative dose if you are giving 60 gray. Here 7435. A huge increase in your overdose and a huge increase in your overdose to a tumor. So that's why it is extremely difficult to plan one field per day treatment to ensure a homogeneous dose to a tumor while sparing the normal tissues on the periphery. This problem exacerbates lower the energy you are. And unfortunately, lower energy typically means cobalt, and cobalts are typically would be used in centers with a high patient load. So it's basically a catch-22 situation. Nonetheless, for your purpose, please remember, as a junior, in modern day radiotherapy, there is very little scope of doing this treatment. Now let's look at multiple fields, and we start off with a poll again. Let's go to this poll. And in this poll, I'm asking the question that here you have got three beam managements for treating this circular tumor. One is a two field, one is a four field, one is an eight field. The question that I'm asking is, which of these field arrangements would you prefer for treatment, assuming that this tumor is in a pediatric patient? Meanwhile, just somebody from OnePlus has said beam flatness may also be explained as almost uniform intensity. Yes, along the plane which is perpendicular to the central axis of the beam. Not uniform intensity, is actually you never get uniform intensity. You get a difference in the dose, and that dose distribute difference is basically what we need to see. And this, remember, beam flatness is applicable for flattened beams. It is not true for unflattened beams. Okay, 57%, 56% of the people have voted. Very good. Okay. Some votes are still trickling in. I will still wait for 10 more seconds. Okay, perfect. End polling. Okay, now the answers are quite revealing actually. 31% of you feel that the two field is acceptable. 25% of the field think that the three field is acceptable. It should be four field, not three field, but anyway. 41% feels the eight field is probably better. And only 5% feel that none of the beam arrangements is correct. The answer is none of the above. Why? Sorry. The answer is that all of these beams are wrong. What has happened over here is that you see the tumor and you see the field. The first principle that I told you when you are doing treatment planning is that you have to account for the beam penumbra. Here, have I accounted for the beam penumbra? The answer is no, I have not. I haven't given a margin to the tumor. And as a consequence of this, for each of these situations, you can see the penumbra comes into play. But as the number of field increases, the effect of the penumbra or the size of the dose reduction because of the penumbra in the tumor volume reduces. Now, this is a very important concept to understand, right? When you are doing things like IMRT, multi-field arrangement, your physicist will often keep a very tight margin. One thing you have to remember is that just because you are doing multi-field arrangement does not mean that the penumbra has gone away. The penumbra still exists. Is just that the scatter contributions of the other field are reducing it. I have not gone into any of the problems associated with motion over here. Even for a static target like this, you can immediately understand that none of these beam arrangements are optimal beam arrangements. If you are talking about a pediatric patient, I would like to bring about the concept of integral dose over here. You can understand that this is not really a good arrangement because this is a tumor situated depth in the center. If you give with an APPA field, you have got a higher dose in the periphery. You can go for a higher energy, but what happens over here is that you tend to get more lateral edge effects. This is the lateral edge effect. And as a result of which, you can potentially run into problems of late toxicity. This spills the dose out everywhere. And if it is a pediatric patient with a highly curable malignancy, if this will give nearly the same dose distribution as this, you know that this would result in a slightly higher risk of increased second malignancy. But this is not always true. The choice of the field depends on what is lying here, what is lying here, what is lying here, and what is lying here. And therefore, depending upon where the organ of risks are, your choice of field geometry changes. Now, just imagine that this is a craniopharyngioma in the center of the brain, right? I can tell you that this is a suboptimal beam arrangement and this is a preferred beam arrangement. And if you ask me, do we have clinical evidence for this? The answer is yes. Please go and read Dr. Jalali's paper on the neurocognitive effects when you are doing a more conformal radiotherapy in patients with pediatric brain tumors as compared to this kind of beam arrangements or this kind of beam arrangement, and you will understand that this beam arrangement is superior in that situation, although the integral dose is more. So this is a very important thing to understand, is that planning is not a unidimensional process. You need to take into account many different things, while an isodose chart is just one part of the equation. Now we are shifting gears, going into a very important beam modifying device known as wedges. This is a key beam modifying device. And all of you who have gone to the machine would have seen something like this. The wedge filters tilt the isotopes by a certain angle, and there are several types of wedge filters. The purpose for using the wedge filters are three: to make the dose homogeneous when you have beams which are angled away from 180 degree, typically less than 180 degree, for compensating for meshing tissues, and to correct for dose fall off along one axis. We have two broad types of wedges, physical wedges and non-physical wedges. I will not go into extensive details of this. If you want to have questions on this, I would welcome it. But overall, what I can tell you is that physical wedges are wedges which you have either in your hand or attached to the collimator. So this is the motorized wedge. A non-physical wedge is a wedge which you cannot see, but you can generate. So what does the wedge do? A wedge basically tilts the isodose line. From this dotted shape, it tilts it. And how does it tilt it? By producing an uniform change in the fluence along the axis perpendicular to the central axis. Now what happens over here is that this portion of this material attenuates less of the photon beam as compared to this portion, and as a result of which the isodose tilts like this. Now what is the wedge angle? The answer, if you read Faz Khan, is this is the angle of the wedge, basically the angle by which it is tilted from a plane which is perpendicular to the central axis, which I think is a simple definition to remember. But many old people will ask you to use this word complement because that's what they have been doing. And it is the complement of the angle subtended to the central axis at the 10 centimeter. It's basically the same thing. Okay. Now, angle between the central axis of the two beams, when you have got two angled beams, is called as the hinge angle. This is an important angle to remember. One thing too important, this is a trick point. Wedges can both harden and soften the beam. How do they harden the beam? Very simple. You have an attenuating material. So what will it do? It will take out the low energy photons. And what results, what comes out of it, will have higher energy. And how does it soften the beam? It softens the beam by producing Compton interaction. As a result of which, what happens is that the photon that comes out, particularly from this side, even from this side, will have a more low energy photon. Now, what this implies is that you typically want this filter to be placed away from the patient's surface such that you do not get an excess dose to the skin. So that's why wedge filters will be placed as close as possible to the gantry. Wedges will also attenuate the beam, right? Simple. You have a thick material over here made of lead or stainless steel. Of course, the beam is going to get attenuated. And as a result of which, what you have to do is to make sure that to get the dose to this point, you have to increase the dose or the output of the machine by a certain factor, which is known as the wedge factor. This is typically true when you are using a physical wedge. Now, why wedges, right? Let's take a look at this dose distribution. This is a typical anterior beam and a lateral beam coming from 90 degrees angle on the periphery. I have shaded the area to make things more clearer for you. And this is the useful area of the beam. Why is this a useful area? Because this is the zone which receives a dose between 95 to 105% of the dose. Now, unfortunately, you are very unlikely to get a tumor like this with no OARs here and no OARs here. So that's why you would never use this beam arrangement. And why does this happen? The reason why this happens is that the isodose from this beam and the isodose from this beam are not parallel to each other. What do I mean by parallel? Remember this plot? We had 140% here, we had 140% here, we had 140% here. Why did this happen? It's because they were parallel to each other and they compensated for each other. So 70 is compensating for 70, 80 is compensating for 50 and so on. So that's why you get a homogeneous dose distribution. Let's go back. Okay, so what is happening over here is that two beam profiles. I like beam profiles. You can get it in any treatment planning system. This is the beam profile of along this line. So this is the red is the anterior beam and green is the lateral beam. So along this line, we know that the isodose which comes from the lateral will be perfectly straight. The isodose which comes from this anterior beam is falling, right? Falling, simple PDD. And as a result of which, these two, along these two, you can see, they are never parallel to each other. And therefore, what is happening is, there is a heterogeneous dose distribution. Now, this can be easily rectified if we introduce a filter which basically tilts the isodose. So, instead of having the isodose which is flat on this dimension from the lateral, we tilt this isodose so that it is parallel to this isodose. And so, what will happen is, here there is a thicker edge, here there is a thicker edge. This isodose will be like this, this isodose will be like this. And what will happen is that along where the isodoses meet, you will have a uniform dose. You can immediately see the area of the field is now getting covered by the useful dose distribution. Now I said that, okay, fine, you have different beam energies. Does different beam energies result or affect your decision to use wedges? The answer is yes. It is not true that you have to use wedges all the time for all situations. This is a scenario. What happens is the same beam geometry, I've just changed the energy to 15 MV. Look what happens. Your 95% isodose is now much more useful. And if you relax your planning constraints a bit, right? You say 107 is fine for me. You can actually use this beam if you have a tumor located over here. Now, the problem is that you would never be using 15 MV beams for treating such superficial tumors. Why? Because you can see what is happening to the 95%, right? It's much deeper. And you will, of course, have a lot of dose spillage on the other side. But this illustrates the point is that if you have got a higher energy beam, your requirement for wedge reduces, or your wedge angle requirement reduces. This is a very important concept to remember. Now, which wedge to be used? Here in panel A and panel B, you can see that the dose distributions are exactly reversed. What has happened over here is that I have used a higher wedge. What does that mean? I have used a 60 degree wedge. Here, I have used a 10 degree wedge. Now, when I use a lower wedge, what happens is that over here, there is not sufficient dose coming in from this side, the thin edge. Over here, there is some attenuation, but it is not sufficient. So I'm not really modifying the dose distribution much. This is the 60 degree, which is bang opposite. What happens over here is that there is significant attenuation of the beam, significant overdose coming in from this side. So as you can see that the 105% isodose has completely shifted from this corner to this corner. This is very important to understand and remember. And that is why proper selection of the wedge angle is extremely important. Now, for typical situations like this, the hinge angle or the angle between the central axis of the two beams is 90 degrees. And the proper wedge angle is 90 minus half of the hinge angle, which is 45 degrees. So the dose distribution which we saw previously was obtained when we got 45 degree angles. If we use higher wedges, what happens is that you push the dose towards the extreme edge of the field. If you use lesser wedges, what happens? The isodose overdose remains towards the superficial side of the beam. Now let's take another alternative scenario. Here we have a hinge angle of 60 degree, or that is the central axis to this midpoint distance is 30 degree. What is the correct wedge angle? 90 minus 60 by 2 or 30, so 60 degree. This is the 30 degree wedge, this is the 30 degree wedge, this is a 60 degree wedge. And you can easily understand and appreciate that the useful area is much more. Is this relationship always true? The answer is no. It depends upon your irradiation conditions, the depth of your target, and so on. Here is a hinge angle of 120 degrees. What would be the correct wedge angle? 30 degrees. See the 30 degree wedge and 60 degree wedge. Why is this happening? Because I have cheated. What is the cheating I have done? The cheating I have done is that I have used a low energy beam for treating this much depth coming from this much separation. So that is why when you are using wedges, it is not always a simple 90 minus 5 by 2. It depends. So that is why it is important to understand that if you are using wedges or any beam modifying device, you need to review your isodose distributions. Okay? Pole time. Okay, we are going to P5, relaunch polling. Right. Three situations over here. Situation 1, 2, and 3. Which of them is the correct wedge position? Good, good, good. Very good. Perfect. And meanwhile, let me take a look at the questions. What do we say when we mean normalize to the Dmax or isocenter? Okay, that's a good question. Normalize means where we want to prescribe our dose. Normalize, say you want to prescribe 200 centigrade. Normalize means you prescribe, give 200 centigrade to the Dmax. For isocenter, it means you give 200 centigrade to the isocenter, which is typically located at a depth. Two field and four field, which one will get us more homogeneous dose and why? The answer is always a four field dose distribution will be more homogeneous, simply because of the fact that when you are using four fields from four sides, you're distributing the dose and you're taking care of the lateral edge effect, which happens when you're delivering the beam from one side. Sir, I'm assuming pediatric patients are thin and two fields are good enough and have less possibility of lateral edge effect and less hourglass distribution. Please clarify. You saw the dose distribution on the Phantom, right? It was not really homogeneous. So I think the answer is clear. No video, voice is cracking. Okay, sorry about that. Okay, so 1.11120. Yep, most of you have voted. Who are voting? End poll. Okay, 70% of you have got it correct, and 30% have not. Okay, what is the correct beam arrangement? Let's see, and then understand why. So what happened over here? Situation one. What is happening is that I am planning to give a dose to this area. Now, this is a typical thing which happens when you are trying to compensate for missing tissue. Okay. So this area, the tissue is less. This area, tissue is more. If you try to treat it without wedges, what will happen is that you will get less dose here, more dose here. What happens is that if you put the thick edge of the beam, you will further attenuate the beam coming on this side. As a result, your underdose here will increase. Because this is a thin side and your output has increased because of use of wedge factor, the overdose will increase even further. So that's why the correct beam wedge arrangement is this. Situation number two, what is the purpose of using the wedge? The purpose of using the wedge is the fact that this anterior beam has a falling isodose distribution. So this area receives more dose as compared to this area. And therefore, if you put the wedge like this, it will further exacerbate the problem. What will happen over here is that this is a thin edge. There is a wedge factor which has resulted in increased output. So here overdose is going to increase. This is the thick edge, more attenuation. Here the anterior field is giving less dose. So the underdose will even more increase. Okay. So this is the correct wedge distribution. And finally, this is correct. Because what is happening is this is basically going in this way. So you have lesser dose here. You have lesser dose here. You have more dose over here. And that's why this will ensure that this will give the proper dose distribution. Now, where in the next question, let me put a poll again. Now you'll have polls on every slide. Okay. So, where should I wedge? I think I put the wrong poll. Wait. I think I put the wrong poll. Sorry. Let me put the, yeah, this is the correct poll. Yeah. So the question is, which side do you want the wedge to be in? This is a typical breast plan, okay? Both sides, medial tangent, lateral tangent, and neither. Now, of course, why you want to use the wedge is to reduce the heterogeneity. Okay, here you are using the wedge as a missing tissue compensator. Okay. Okay. Wait for some more time. 60% of people have voted. We don't have any new questions coming in, so that's good. Okay, good. Let's end this poll. I think 65% of the people have voted and we are not getting a new question. Okay, the answer is that you can, of course, wedge both the sides. I would prefer not to wedge the medial tangent. You know why? See the breast on this side. What will happen is that if you put a wedge, particularly a physical wedge on this side, you will get a lot of scatter radiation coming into the breast on this side, which will increase the dose unnecessarily. See this overdose, it is actually lying towards the lateral tangent, right? It is superficially placed. I would probably prefer to put the wedge only on the lateral tangent. I would definitely not want to wedge only the medial tangent. I would definitely want to start from the lateral tangent, see how the dose distribution goes, and then wedge the medial tangent if required. Okay, second poll. And here we go. Two scenarios. Which one would you need a higher wedge angle? Again, the situation is same, missing tissue compensation. Where will be the thick end? Okay, that is a good point. The thick end is always towards the side where you want the attenuation to be more. So think about where would you want to have the thick end on breast plans. I will give the answer after the poll opens, closes. Okay. Good. Very good. Nearly 62, 63, some people are still voting. Okay, let's end. So most of you got it right. This one is the one where you would need to use a higher wedge. And the reason is the change in the contour. See what is happening. This contour is vastly more conical. What is missing tissue? Let's see. When would you have not required wedges? If your contour was shaped like this, a block, right? Here the deficit is vastly more as compared to the deficit here. Here the missing tissue is much less. So you require a lower compensation and therefore wedge angle requirement is lesser. And regarding putting the thick edge, I will put the thick edge on this direction, thin edge on this direction. Why? Because I want to reduce the dose over here. I want to attenuate. Okay, next poll. I think this is the last poll and we are coming to the end of this presentation also. So we'll launch it once more. Okay, the question is where to wedge. Would you increase the wedge angle for the lateral tangent? Would you decrease the wedge angle for the lateral tangent? Add a wedge on the medial tangent or you will do none of the above? Okay, some votes are still coming in. Now they have stopped. Okay, fine, good. End polling. Thank you all for participating in the poll. And this one I put at the last because this is a very tricky situation. The answer is none of the above. Why? What will happen if you increase the wedge angle? Your overdose over here and here will increase. Here the overdose will reduce, but this will increase the overdose on this side. Decrease the wedge angle for lateral tangent. What will happen is that this and this will slightly reduce. This one less as compared to this. This will increase. What happens if you add a wedge in the medial? You get no big advantage. It's basically the same as increasing the wedge on the lateral tangent. But nonetheless, your dose distribution is nearly similar, right? So if this was preferentially on one side, you would have gained some advantage of using a medial tangent. But in this dose distribution, putting a medial tangent wedge will not help you much. The answer is that you do not want to use a wedge in this situation, or you want to do some kind of beam balancing or a field-in-field technique to basically get the dose distribution correct. So you'll have to use a little bit of different weightage with different wedge angles, differential wedge angles in this situation to actually get all these three hotspots removed. And believe me, if you have done clinical breast planning, once you have reached this endpoint, you can rest assured that without using a field-in-field technique or a sub-field technique, you cannot get rid of this situation. So this is very important to understand. What about non-physical wedges? I will just briefly show you with an animation what the non-physical wedges basically do. Is that essentially we move the collimator. Typically, it would be the Y collimator. And as a result of this, what happens is that your dose distribution becomes more forward peak. Why is this happening? See, when this collimator is out of the beam, isodose is perfectly same, moves in, this portion of the beam gets attenuated, this portion does not, your isodose becomes peaked. More isodose becomes more peak. Have you got the wedge angle? Yes, you have. Of course, this is not as simple as it sounds. It's vastly more complicated. Commissioning these non-physical wedges is more complicated. And I put this last table to help you along the reading as a comparison between the physical wedge and the virtual wedge. One thing I would like to tell you, virtual wedges are not without their faults. They require more QA and they are more susceptible to motion because they have a moving collimation. So if the tumor is moving in the direction where the collimation is moving, it will receive a higher dose. If the tumor is moving in the direction which is opposite to where the collimator is moving, it will receive a lower dose. So that's why you should be very careful when you are using virtual wedges in tumors that move, unless and until you are using a gating technique. So thank you. I would like to thank my team at Tata Medical Center who help us to do these kind of things. Without them being present, I wouldn't have had the time to make all of these slide presentations, talk to you and discuss with you. We are having a fellowship opportunity at Tata Medical Center. We will be having the interview on Thursday. And we have this course, which is the advanced certification course in clinical oncology and research, where we have a 3-year program where we have integrated clinical oncology training in evidence-based medicine, advanced radiation techniques, along with clinical research and advanced research in IIT Kharagpur. So we are going to have the interview this Thursday. You can still send in your applications if you're interested. And with this, I would like to thank the team who has resulted in organization of this class. I think one last question which I'll answer. Sir, can the field-in-field technique increase skin reactions compared to a plan without field-in-field? It is unlikely. The reason is that skin reactions typically depend upon a lower energy photon beam being present. So a field-in-field technique typically does not increase your low energy photons that much because these are implemented through MLCs which are placed sufficiently far away from the beam. Okay, I think that is correct. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Santam sir, for the excellent class. These are some topics that a radiation oncologist must know while he is entering the planning room. And thanks very much for explaining all these difficult things so lucidly and so nicely. Thank you very much. And thank you, everyone. Good night.
Good night.